Welcome to 2819. I'm Sandra Dimas.
And I'm Brian Rollenbacher.
And we have a big old amazing show for you today.
We're going to be chatting with astronomer Hugh Ross, biochemist Fazale Rana, and some others.
They'll be addressing such topics as if Noah's flood really covered the entire Earth, why we pursue monogamy in marriage, and also the big questions that people ask.
Before we jump into our first segment, we want to remind you that the viewer survey ends this week, so be sure to check that out and get your voice heard.
Yes, 2819 is a viewer-supported show, and it's very important to us to make sure that you are heard. So visit reasons.org/2819 to fill out that survey and let us know what you think.
Well, now it's time for RTB 101. Krista Bontrager will talk with astrophysicist Jeff Zweerink, answering the question, does the Earth's magnetic field indicate a recent creation?
Let's check it out.
Now it's time for RTB 101, where we discuss practical questions to equip you to share your faith more effectively. And here to help me talk about a very important topic, the magnetic field of the Earth, is Dr. Jeff Zweerink.
Hi, Krista. It's good to be here.
Glad to have you back. Now, we're going to get into a discussion about the age of the Earth and the universe. So let's start with, what does Reasons to Believe say about the age of the universe?
Well, we think the scientists largely have the time scales right, that the universe is about 14 billion years old, the Earth is about 4.5 billion years old, and humanity is on the order of 100,000 years old. So the time scales that the scientists have, that's correct. That's our position.
Now, there are some Christians who take a different opinion about that. They would say that the Earth is only thousands of years old. And one of the evidences that they use for that is something called the magnetic field of the Earth. So let's start to wade into that a little bit. What is their argument?
Well, so a little bit of background. So the Earth has a magnetic field. That's why, in fact, that's how we use our compasses. That's how we know what north is. Well, actually, before GPS, that's how we figured out what north was, because you take a magnet, and if you kind of exclude it from other influences, it will point north because the Earth has this magnetic field. So that's very useful for navigating. You're out in the middle of the ocean, want to know which way north is, can't see the stars, compass will tell you that. Now, back in the 1800s was the first time, you know, so you could put a magnet in a magnetic field that will point north, but about 1845 or so, we were actually able to measure the strength of the magnetic field. And what we found in the 100, 150 years since is that the magnetic field has been decaying. It's dropped off anywhere 5 to 10% from that original measurement back in the 1800s. And so that kind of is the impetus, or is the evidence, if you will, for this argument that the magnetic field of the Earth is decaying. It could only have been so large, therefore the Earth couldn't be any older than a few thousand years.
So I think I understand. So when we started measuring the magnetic field, 1845, and to today, we see like, oh, it's decreased this much.
Right.
So if I work that mathematical number backwards, billions of years is too long, the magnetic field should have completely decayed by now. So therefore, the Earth must be only thousands of years old?
Sort of. It's like, okay, we see it decaying. And so you extrapolate that back and say it couldn't have been much stronger than this value. So, you know, if you go back a few thousand years, that's not that large. If you go back a few billion years, if assuming that kind of just steady decrease, that would be this enormous magnetic field that's unphysical and couldn't happen. And so that's the line of reasoning.
Okay. So help us begin to think about a response to this argument. Because on the surface, that sounds sort of somewhat compelling for me as a non-scientist.
No, actually, you're right. I find a lot of these arguments seem compelling until you investigate a little more, because the key in this is recognizing that the Earth's magnetic field isn't steady. So it's not like it was just really strong in the past and it's slowly been decaying. We're making this measurement and that tells us where we are. What we find is evidence that the Earth's magnetic field is actually increasing and decreasing and increasing and decreasing over time. And so we've got evidence, not the least of which is like evidence from the seafloor, where we look at and find where the magnetic field is reversed. So we find it decaying and getting stronger in one direction, then growing and getting stronger in the other direction. And so that's the idea of a steady monotonic magnetic field is not what the evidence says. What the evidence says is that Earth's magnetic field flip-flops quite often throughout history.
Oh, that's interesting. So rather than just being a steady decrease over time, it's a bit fluctuating.
Yeah, I mean, if you were going to be really extreme about it, and this is a little bit obnoxious here, is we could say, you know, the Earth is no more than a few hours old because I went outside at 3 o'clock and I see the sun going down in the sky, and I know it couldn't have been any higher than this, and so that means the Earth is only about 4 hours old. Well, what that misses is that the sun goes up and it goes down, and then it goes up and then it goes down. That's what's going on with the magnetic field as well.
Oh, that makes sense. Okay, so that leads me back to scripture. It makes me wonder, is there anything in scripture that would compel me to believe that the Earth is only thousands of years old?
You know, I don't think there is. There's nothing in scripture that talks about the magnetic field. That's a fairly recent discovery, if you will. But what I find is, as I've looked at Christians who investigate scripture, hold scripture in high regard, you know, the authority and inerrancy of scripture, and want to know what scripture has to say, and you'll find Christians who in that camp, who some who say the earth is young and a few thousand years old, and others who say, no, I look at scripture and the best interpretation is that the earth really is much older than that. And so to me, that's a question that scripture doesn't answer, or rather the way I would say it is, the fact that you've got Christians who know how to interpret scripture, who hold it in high regard, believe it's inerrant, has authority, and who investigate it closely, and they come down on different positions, that says that scripture isn't clear about what it is, in spite of what many young earth creationists who will say that, oh, it's very clear that these are meant to be 24-hour days in the earth, a few thousand years old.
So when I think about that, if scripture leaves that question open, then that makes me think I can go out into the record of nature and investigate and see what nature has to say about the age of the earth. And that can kind of help me figure it all out and put all those pieces together.
Well, and to me, that's just a really exciting prospect because I love understanding how things work. And so, you know, in scripture, there's this idea of the two books, that scripture is God's revelation, but scripture tells us that God's revealed himself in creation. And so there are things that scripture doesn't give us the final answer, but it tells us, hey, go look at creation, understand what's going on, because that will tell you how God works, who he is, and how he's done things as well. And as a scientist, that's just fascinating, and a message I said, hey, let's go out and tell people about this.
And that's a great segue to just motivating us to go share the gospel. We want to get people excited about studying both of God's books, the Bible and the record of nature.
Absolutely. I love being able to study both. And the fact that they tell me the same story, give me the same evidence, and point to the same God is a powerful tool that there really is a God behind it all.
Well, thanks for helping us understand about the Earth's magnetic field a little bit more. And I do want to encourage you, go check out Jeff's blog called Impact Events at reasons.org. Next up, we're going to watch a clip from visiting scholar Dr. Balajied Nongrum talking about the big questions humans ask. Let's check it out.
Balajied, it seems that the Western world and the Eastern world sometimes seem like two different universes, if you will. I guess my question for you is this. Do people ask the same types of questions in India that they might ask in New York City, or do they ask very different type questions?
From my interaction or from my speaking engagement that I do on a regular basis, especially in that part of the world, I find that, the questions are basically the same. Mm. Questions such as, who am I? Where do I come from? Why are we here? What's the meaning of our existence? Or what is the purpose of life? Or what happens after we die? You know, or what does it mean to be human? Some of these questions, irrespective of the background or the religious background that they come from or any other perspective that they come, but I find that the questions are generally the same. And I think this is important for us to understand that the scriptures is very clear when it speaks about this. It says that, you know, when Paul was speaking to the Athenians, he in fact refers to something that is similar to what we are talking about, that, you know, God has created each one of us, right, in his own image. And as he has created us, he has also placed us in different location, different time. But nevertheless, he has also set in our hearts that desire that we will look out for him, we will search for him, we will long for him. And I think at the end of the day, when you really look, especially in the East, or maybe in the West, I find that somehow we are incredibly religious people deep in our hearts.
Now when we think about a different worldview's view of human beings, does this philosophical search, this quest that human beings have, does this differentiate us from the animals in kind, or is it merely in degree? That is, what does Christianity say that makes such a big difference in human beings as opposed maybe to the animal kingdom?
I think the Bible is very clear with regard to this, not only in terms of propositional truth that it reveals to us about the nature of our existence and in difference from the other creatures that that are there. But I think the Bible, in a very categorical language, says that we, as human beings, we are created in the image of God. Or when you go back to the scriptures, the word that is used is the imago Dei, mm-hmm. the image of God. So it is perhaps because of that that sets us different from, let's say, any other creatures that are there in this world. So I think we are unique, we are different, and in fact it is only human beings that have these kinds of questions. I have, being a veterinarian myself, I have not come across, you know, a conference of animals coming together and discussing on the questions of the origin, meaning and purpose of life.
Right.
I think it is only we human beings who talk about this and who discuss about this, and I think the Bible gives us a very clear description of the fact that you and I are created in the image of God.
For more on that topic, go to reasons.org and search for Balajied Nongrum. Now it's time for Culture Talk, where we discuss culturally relevant topics that you can use to start conversations about your faith. I'm joined today with astronomer Hugh Ross. Thank you for joining us.
Hello.
We're going to be talking about a common question that we receive, not only from Christians, but non-Christians alike. And is it possible for Noah's flood to really cover the entire earth?
It's not scientifically possible, mm-hmm. and it's biblically impossible. The Bible does not teach that the flood was global. It explicitly tells us it was less than global. Mm-hmm. Passages like 2 Peter 2:5 says that it covered the world of ungodly people. There was no ungodly people at the time living in Antarctica, so there's no need for God to extend the flood. But probably the most explicit texts would be the ones we see in the wisdom books, Job and Psalms and Proverbs. Psalm 104, the longest of the creation psalms, takes you through much of the content of the 6 days. When it addresses creation day 3, it talks about God transforming earth from a water world to where there's oceans and continents coexisting. That's verses 6, 7, and 8. And it says, once the continents are in place, verse 9, never again will water cover the whole face of the earth. So that's a text that explicitly tells us the flood of Noah wiped out the entire world of ungodly people and all the animals associated with them, but it was not a global event.
So then what you're saying, talking about the verses in Psalm, that this happened prior to Noah's flood, and it says, never again shall these waters cover the entire earth.
Yeah, creation day 3 mm-hmm. talks about when earth was water over the whole surface,
right.
and let the land masses appear. Mm-hmm. And that gets repeated again in Job 38, Proverbs 8, and Psalm 104. And in Psalm 104, it talks about how once these continents are in place, they have a permanent barrier. Never again will water cover the face of the earth. Job 38 likewise says that they have a permanent barrier to the waters.
So what I love about this perspective is that it forces us to look through the entirety of scripture to really find a deeper understanding of what events like Noah's flood meant and the extent, for example, of the flood. So if the flood wasn't global in the sense that it didn't cover the entire earth, but it did cover all of humanity during
all the locations where humanity lived.
Right. So then what was the extent of the flood?
Well, we know from Genesis that God scattered humanity from one locale to all the places over the land masses. That's Genesis chapter 10 and 11. And the flood is previous to that. And notice we have God commanding Adam and Eve, multiply and fill the earth. They didn't do it. The reason why we know God repeated the command to Noah and his sons, multiply and fill the earth, they didn't do it either. God had to forcibly scatter humanity over the face of the earth. And we actually have DNA evidence that tells us that humanity was in one locale and then quickly covered all the other continental land masses with the exception of Antarctica.
So then humanity was not fulfilling God's call to
you know, fill the earth and be fruitful and multiply, essentially. So then after the flood event and after humanity gets scattered, then that's when it happened.
Right. We knew at a minimum it had to cover all the Mesopotamian plains because of the geographical place names we see mentioned. It also talks about the land of Nod, which we know is in southern Iran. So it had to cover that area. And it tells us in Genesis 8 that it took 7.5 months for the floodwaters to recede, which means there had to be an extensive amount of melting snow and ice to replace the water that's flowing out into the Indian Ocean. So it tells me this has happened during the last ice age, which means the Persian Gulf would have been mostly dry land. So I think it's about 1 million square miles. I actually put a map in my book, Navigating Genesis, showing the probable extent of the flood at the time of Noah. And yeah, it's about 4 times bigger than what you see in most old earth interpretations of the flood, because we put the date during the last ice age.
So what does the scientific data say? Is there any sort of evidence, geological records that show that there was a significant flood?
What's interesting is we find flood layers in the Mesopotamian plain, but they're not the flood of Noah. Hmm. And wouldn't expect to find any, because the flood only lasted 13 months. In order to leave a significant flood deposit, we would need to have a certain kind of geological event. And to give you an example, there was a 50-foot flood that covered a huge area of Mississippi just 30 years ago, and it lasted for 4 months. There's zero evidence of that today. We're only talking 30 years. Whereas in the case of the flood, we're having to go back thousands of years. So it's no surprise we have no scientific evidence.
So there's no scientific evidence that there was a significant flood.
Well, we can't rule out that there was scientific evidence for it, because you wouldn't expect to find evidence given the locale and the duration of the flood.
What would we expect if there were a global flood? Would there be scientific evidence?
There definitely would be.
So what would that look like, and do we see that?
Well, for example, you would have to have the mountains pushed up a huge amount. You would need plate tectonics of a dramatic amount. Mm-hmm. We would need to see evidence of significant changes in the laws of physics. And we don't see that in the measurements of the Earth or the universe. In astronomy, we can look back in time and see what's happened to the laws of physics. We see no change. And there's a biblical reason. The Bible tells us that the laws that govern the universe and the Earth do not change. Mm-hmm. And so that rules out anything of such a catastrophic nature that it would actually cover all the land masses on planet Earth with water. Moreover, I've talked about this in Navigating Genesis. A big problem with the global flood model, it doesn't permit the existence of life. Mm. And it tells us in the text that Noah and his family and their animals survived the event.
Right. Well, thank you so much for that. It's certainly a deep topic. If you'd like to hear more on this topic, go to shop.reasons.org and search for Hugh's book, Navigating Genesis. Now we're going to head to give and take. Jeff Zweerink will talk with Fazale Rana about why we pursue monogamy in marriage. Let's check it out.
Hello, Jeff Zweerink, and welcome back to Give and Take, the segment of our show where we explore important scientific ideas and how they point to the God of the Bible. Today I'm joined by Fuzz Rana, and we're going to look at the origin of monogamy and how that points to a creator. Fuzz, good to have you here today.
Jeff.
So let's kind of get right at the bottom line there. I'm curious, what do the origins of monogamy have anything to do with pointing to a creator?
Yeah, well, you know, when you think about monogamy, you probably, like most people, would think about a relationship between two human beings where they're committed to each other for life.
Right.
But the fact of the matter is, monogamy is observed in the animal world, mm-hmm. where there are some species where the mates will pair or bond for life. And so, and other species where that's not observed. So scientists are trying to understand, in evolutionary terms, the origin of monogamy. Mm-hmm. And what they've uncovered is something that is very uncomfortable for the evolutionary paradigm. It doesn't fit in the evolutionary paradigm. But so, makes so this, perfect sense if a creator.
Okay. So it's this kind of tension that evolution has a difficulty explaining it, but it makes sense in a creation context.
Yes.
So what is it about monogamy that points toward or that makes it look like there's a creator that's instantiated it?
Well, there was a study done just recently where researchers were trying to understand what were the genetic basis for monogamous behavior. Mm-hmm. And so they had a number of species that represent animals across the animal kingdom, mm-hmm. where you had sister species where one was monogamous, one was non-monogamous. Mm. And so they looked at genetic differences in the neural tissue for the monogamous versus the non-monogamous species. Mm-hmm. And what they discovered was a set of 24 genetic changes that impacted 24 different genes that were consistent in the monogamous species versus the non-monogamous species.
So that would point to me that this is a fairly complex change. It's not just something you would expect kind of run-of-the-mill or expect right. a lot to pop up. 24 things that kind of work together, that's just hard to do.
Right. So the improbability of those 24 changes happening in a single species is fairly remote. But for those same changes to happen independently in species that would be, from an evolutionary perspective, separated, their lineages would have been separated from each other for 450 million years, indicates that these genetic changes occurred independently, but in an identical way in each of these different lineages.
So if you'd had some 450 million year old monogamous species that populated or gave rise to the rest, that would be easier to do. But the fact that you've got these kind of related pairs that some are monogamous and non-monogamous, and then across the animal kingdom and different ones, it's the fact that some are, some aren't, and yet they all share this common genetic signature, if you will.
Right. So it's one thing to think that maybe monogamous behavior arose independently in an evolutionary context, but for it to arise independently and be driven by the identical genetic changes is really uncomfortable. And even the researchers that were looking at this result that were, again, steeped within the evolutionary paradigm expressed dismay at this particular result.
Seems like this is something that shows this kind of phenomena where you've got disparate or the same features showing up in disparate species, that seems to be a relative. I know I've heard you talk about that before. Is this a common thing? How common? What do scientists,
about this? This is an example of what's called convergence, mm-hmm. which in a nutshell means that you have organisms that are not related to each other that have identical or near identical biological features. And this can be at the organismal level, you know, anatomical, physiological, mm-hmm. Identical features, or even at the biochemical or the genetic level, and it looks as if they arose independently, again, multiple times. And this phenomenon is called convergence, and it's problematic because you wouldn't expect convergence in an evolutionary scenario.
Explain why.
Yeah, because evolution is a historically contingent process, meaning it's predicated on a sequence of chance events. And the likelihood of repeating those chance events in the same identical way two separate times is highly remote. Mm-hmm. So Stephen Jay Gould, the evolutionary biologist, used this metaphor that if you could rewind the tape of life and replay it, the expectation is the outcome would be different. Because if you altered even one of those events mm-hmm. in that sequence ever so slightly, you'd send the evolutionary trajectory in different directions. So we've got these discordant observations. One is that evolution should be historically contingent and shouldn't repeat. And the other is that we see countless examples of where it looks like as if evolution repeatedly hit upon the same outcome. And this origin of monogamy is an extreme example, in my opinion, where, again, you're looking at these 24 mm-hmm. identical genetic changes in different species.
Yeah, that really does strike me as a very difficult thing to just have happen multiple times. So it has this problematic or troublesome explanation within an evolutionary paradigm. As from a creationist perspective, how do we look at that?
Well, to me, I think that this idea of convergence fits elegantly in a creation model or a design framework. And think about it this way. Engineers oftentimes, once they figure out a solution to a problem, mm-hmm. will redeploy it independently multiple times. When I worked for in R&D for a Fortune 500 company, we had a mantra that was called search and reapply.
Right.
Don't invent something new. See what we have on the shelf and try to pull it off and use it to develop your technology.
That's most of the way I computer program. And I mean, it's foundation to how we computer program is use what's already there, mm-hmm. maybe modify it a little bit. So
yeah, so to me, if there is a creator responsible for the diversity of life and the designs we see in biology, then you'd expect convergence to be a widespread feature. So to me, it's not only a challenge to the evolutionary paradigm, but it's exactly how I would expect nature to look if there was a creator responsible for it.
Well, and I find it interesting that it plays out in something that's very important to human life. You know, we talk about marriage, that's kind of the ultimate close bond you can have mm-hmm. in some sense. The fact that has this feature in it that points towards a creator seems kind of remarkable as well.
Yeah, and it'd be really interesting to see if those same kind of genetic features appear in humans as well as in these animals. That would be really provocative, because there are great apes that are not monogamous, mm-hmm. right? They have a very different reproductive lifestyle. Gorillas and chimpanzees as an example. Mm-hmm. And so it'd be interesting to do that comparative genomic study with humans and with the great apes, where you could make a prediction from a creation model perspective that you would see the same genetic changes in humans as you do in these other species, or the same genetic features, maybe is a better way of saying it.
Thanks, Fuzz. I appreciate your comments. You know, when we look at what Christianity has to say about monogamy, it really does point towards a creator. And I find it interesting, as Fuzz has identified here, that as scientists have explored the origins of monogamy, it really does point towards a creator who's found a mechanism to make it work, employed it multiple times, and trying to explain that behavior within an evolutionary paradigm really struggles to find a good fit. You know, I'd encourage you to go to reasons.org, search for monogamy, and you'll find Fuzz's article on this that will equip you to use this powerful tool to go out and point others to the truth of the Bible.
That does it for us this week on 2819. We hope you enjoyed this episode and that helped equip you to share your faith with confidence and compassion.
And don't forget, find us, subscribe to the show, and search for us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. We are at 2819 Show.
And if you want the podcast version of the show, you can get that anywhere you listen to your podcast. Just search Reasons to Believe Podcast.
See you next week.